He throws that out and then he backs away.
I want to put that out there.
He throws it out and backs away.
I want to let everybody understand.
I have. Speaking of the battle of the UTs in the second round,
it's going down.
It's happening.
I mean, just to clarify, it's not going to be a match. I mean, we're going to demolish Texas.
I've got to win it. I'm going to look at all the presentations again.
They go all the way this year.
That takes all kinds of kinds.
Yeah, it does.
Sounds good. Well,
it's all right.
All right.
My Ags can slip past Nebraska. We have a date with Houston, so it's short-lived.
That's going to be short-lived.
Mr. Chair, I think we have a solution to be able to get started.
Okay, wonderful. Well, it is 5:17, and we'll call to order the March 18, 2024 PNZ work session meeting. And now we will open up for public
comments. Recording in progress.
If anyone has a public comment, please limit your comments to 3 minutes, and please come to the podium, and please state your name and address. Sorry, name and city of residence for the record.
And please keep in mind that there will be other opportunities, certainly during the regular agenda for zoning cases, assuming that you all are here to comment or at least just participate in some form related to zoning cases. There will be public hearings for those, so the public comment section is typically for something other than what's already on the agenda.
Thank you, Brian.
Yep, thank you.
No public comments. We'll go ahead and close that portion, and we'll turn it over to you, Mr. Brian Chandler,
okay.
Planning Director.
All right. Thank you, Chair Marshall, members of the commission. And so we have several items on the agenda, which also including, I guess we'll go over the plat and zoning cases, but of course, Commissioner Weaver, this is his last meeting, and so we want to make sure that we spend a few minutes acknowledging his service, and we got a little something for your service here. But prior to that, let's go ahead and take a look at the regular agenda items. Actually, let's start with consent, because we do have another plat that's on the consent agenda, and this is a one-lot, one-block, 3.5-acre subdivision plat at Waters Dairy and South 5th Street. And just as a reminder to those of you that have been involved in this and to P&Z and some new information to those of you who don't come regularly, that this is a recently implemented policy to be able to have plats that are P&Z is only seen for a simple reason. In this case, it was extension of a sewer line, which triggers Planning and Zoning Commission to have to approve it rather than being a minor plat, which can be approved administratively. So that this is one of those. The only reason that it's on the agenda is because of the requirement to extend a public sewer line. And do you all have any questions about that? Because as we discussed and agreed upon, there is a short presentation that that certainly can be pulled up if y'all had any questions.
I don't think so, Brian.
Okay.
I think we're good.
Mm-hmm. All right, sounds good. And then, so item five, of course, is the minutes, but on the regular agenda, we have item six, FY24-15-ZC. And this is at 1911 West Avenue H. It's an existing church that is a proposed Montessori private elementary school. And so it makes a ton of sense. It looks like a good location for it. Staff is recommending approval, but had to be rezoned because it's currently zoned residential 2F. Any questions on that? Okay. All right. And then the next one is item number seven. And I'm guessing that a lot of the folks here are very interested in this case. This is the latest version of for your consideration for the property at 990 South Kegley Road and 6224 Jupiter Drive. And so we've have discussed this in workshop, just to let you all know this was coming up, because this is the single-family one version of the request, and we'll have a much more detailed presentation. Jason Deckman is still the case manager on this one, because as you all know, this a previous request had been withdrawn after a public hearing at P&Z and a recommendation for denial. They came back, they heard from key stakeholders, including residents, but also those other neighbors that had publicly mentioned different concerns, and they came back and have submitted a single family one application, and rather than the more dense mix of housing types and future retail. So any questions by the commission? And once again, neighbors, you all will have an opportunity during the public hearing, the regular agenda, to comment as well. We do. Jason's got an update. I believe we got an update from the project manager in engineering, the city engineer's office, the latest, which Jason, if you don't have a slide yet, you've at least got
notes. Don't have a slide, but I'll have my email. I'll grab
okay.
it. Sharon had replied this afternoon while we were dealing with all the glitches.
So. Yes, so we have the latest from the project manager in terms of the timing of the Kegley Road improvements.
Drive's going to be treated the same way?
Yes, that is correct. So as was the case with the previous zoning case, the applicant still just intends to use Jupiter Drive as an emergency access, click to enter gate opportunity only for, you know, into this project. The only access would be for emergency vehicles.
Thanks, Brian.
Okay, good question. All right, anything else from the commissioners that can't wait until the regular agenda and the public hearing? All right, number 8 is a zoning case at 6944 Airport Road. And so this is a general retail request. This is directly across from Priority Charter School. And so the request is for a gas station convenience store with fuel pumps, and of course they would be subject to distance requirements, you know, per TABC and per Chapter 4 of our Code of Ordinances for alcohol sales from the school, which pushes their convenience store down towards the southern corner of the property to be able to comply with that. So just a heads up, that's probably going to be one of the biggest questions I would anticipate.
So closer to Amy's Coffee, all that area that they just developed.
Yes, sir. That is correct.
Thank you.
All right. And then the last item on the regular agenda to discuss is a plat for the lofts at Blackland Ranch. And so this is a separate developer from Blackland Ranch, which is you all, I'm sure, have seen if you've been on South 5th near Waters Dairy recently. You see that development is going vertical with some single-family development. But this is a separate developer, but they have taken the same standards and are applying it to fourplexes, townhomes, fourplexes. And so this is the plat that includes that extension. I think one of the most exciting parts of that development is that it would include an extension of King's Court, which would essentially be extended to Fifth Street directly across from Waters Dairy. So that would provide some additional needed access up through the future development and TMED, eventually with future development that could end up connecting to First Street and up to the Loop and the rehab hospital up there. So anyway, that's an exciting part of that project that I just wanted to point out. But it's TMed South, and so it meets the TMed South standards, and in terms of sidewalks and street trees and parks. So any questions about that particular plat? Of course, the zoning was approved months ago, and this is the following up with the subdivision plat. Any questions on that? All right. Well, with that, I guess, Kyle, do we need to read in the recognition for Commissioner
Yes, he
Weaver?
Yes, he for sure does.
Yeah, so let's do it.
He does.
So, yes. Chair Marshall, if you wouldn't mind officially reading in the next item on the workshop agenda. So, or I'll tell you what, I'll do it for you.
Yep, I was saying,
it's
I don't
number
know,
three,
I
and
it.
We kept it very simple. So, recognition of Clint Weaver for his service to PNZ.
Yeah.
And so, Clint, it's been a pleasure working with you. So for the last 3 years, you have certainly made this board better. You've made us as staff better by challenging us, asking, you know, some hard questions, but very good questions, and just your involvement and attention to detail. And so.
Hey, Chris, it's Lexi.
Oh, hi, Lexi.
Hey, just wondering,
all right.
Are you planning on calling into the PNZ, the Temple PNZ?
So Lexi does not realize that she's not muted.
You're there. Okay, great.
There we go.
They wanted to be a part of this.
Yes.
Very important situation.
Yes. So with that, and this is, it says, thank you for your service to the City of Temple Planning and Zoning Commission 2021 to 2024. And we appreciate all that you've done, and we're glad that you get to go back home to Tennessee, take your family there.
Thank you, so, appreciate
yes,
it.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
All right. Thank appreciate you. It. That's all I've got.
Brian, can I add one thing?
Please.
As a parting gift, I noticed I drove the Loop yesterday.
Thank you.
And the flashers are working at Morehouse.
Oh, good. All right.
Yeah, very nice.
There you go.
And a new stop sign.
Excellent.
That's very good.
Oh, tell you what, you get a nice carrying case.
Very good. Thank you, Brian.
All right. Thank you, Clint.
Yeah, thank you. Appreciate you.
At this time, I'll ask for volunteers. First one for the invocation.
I'll do it.
All right. And second for the pledge.
I'll do it.
Okay. Now we'll hear from Ms. Gover regarding affidavits.
Yes, commissioners, for the record, no affidavits to abstain have been received for this meeting. Is this correct? Thank you.
Thank you, Kathy. With no further business on the workshop, we will adjourn the workshop at 5:30 p.m. Anybody need a break before we move into the regular meeting?
Let me check. I think some people have signed in.
Please. Mm-hmm. There you go. Okay. Do we need to wait, or we can go ahead and?
We'll bring it to you.
Wonderful. All right. It is 5:31, and we will now go to order the March 18th, 2024 Planning and Zoning Commission regular meeting. Ms. Gover, may we have the roll, please?
Yes. Good evening, and welcome to the March 18th, 2024 Planning and Zoning Open
session meeting. Commissioners, please stay present if attendance this evening. Commissioner Morales.
Present.
Commissioner Walker.
Present.
Commissioner Jurassic.
Present.
Commissioner Krause. Let the record show Commissioner Krause is not present. Commissioner Weaver.
Present.
Commissioner Jeans. Let the record show Commissioner Jeans is not present. Commissioner Carney. Vice Chair McBride. Let the record show Vice Chair McBride is not present. Chair Marshall.
Present.
For the record, a quorum is present with six commissioners in attendance. Thank you.
Thank you, Kathy. And now we'll be led by Commissioner Weaver in the pledge, I'm sorry, in the invocation, followed by Commissioner Carney in the pledge.
Thank you.
Please rise with me.
Please join me in prayer. Dear Lord, we thank you for this opportunity to do the business in this great city that we call home. We thank you for this, the love and the compassion that's shown between each other. I pray that you'll lead us and guide us in everything we do. We want to honor and glorify you. And it's in your name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Please join me in the pledge. I pledge
allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you all. We will now confirm the meeting agenda items. Commissioners, are there any questions or comments regarding the items?
Can we move number 7 up, since I think the majority of the people here are to speak on number 7 and do it out of order again? So do 7,
as
6, 8,
one.
9.
Okay. Move number 7.
Is everybody good with that?
Kyle, do we need to vote on that, or can we just unanimous?
No,
okay, perfect.
As long as it's on the agenda, you can move it around as necessary.
Wonderful. All right. With that, we will unanimous approve with the shuffling of the agenda items with unanimous consent. And then we will move to public comments. Similarly, as our planning director, Mr. Brian Chandler, stated a second ago, you'll have an opportunity to discuss on the actual case item, but there is a general comments section for non-itemized agenda topics if you so chose to come. We will open up the public comments at this time. If you do, please limit your comments to 3 minutes and please state your name and city of residence for the record. Seeing none, we will close the public comments. And we will move to the consent items. On the consent agenda are the approvals of items number 4. Commissioners, if there are no objections, I'll entertain a motion.
Items 4 and 5.
I'm sorry. Items 4 and 5. That's correct.
Remind me again why we have to do a vote on if it's in the consent agenda. I'm sorry. It's my last one, Kyle. Help me one more time.
Yeah, it's just we need a vote, a record vote on all the plats and stuff. So,
Just a consent agenda
yeah,
as presented.
So you just make a motion that we approve items 4 and 5.
Beautiful, thank you, Kyle. I'll make a motion we approve items 4 and 5 as presented.
Second.
I've got a motion by Commissioner Weaver and a second by Commissioner Morales. May we have a vote, please?
Yes. Commissioner Morales.
Aye.
Commissioner Walker.
Aye.
Commissioner Jurassic.
Aye.
Commissioner Weaver.
Aye.
Commissioner Carney.
Aye.
Chair Marshall.
Aye.
The vote is unanimous and the motion carries.
All right. With that, we're going to move to item number 7, FY-24-17-ZC. Hold a public hearing to discuss and recommend action on a rezoning request from agricultural to plan development single family dwelling 1 with a development site plan on 92.65 acres, known as Bell County Tax Appraisal District Identification Numbers 118191, 118194, 524654, 46804, 46805, generally located east of the existing terminus of Jupiter Drive, commencing on the west side of South Kegley Road, approximately 2,500 feet, south of its intersection with West Adams Avenue, addressed as 990 South Kegley Road and 6224 Jupiter Drive. This case will be presented by Transportation Planner, Mr. Jason Deckman.
All right, good evening, Chair and Commissioners. Thank you for your patience as we've dealt with some of these audio and video glitches. So as Chair Marshall read in the description, we're here tonight for the Planning and Zoning Commission's review of the rezoning on Kegley Road. And the city council schedule is on your screen. It will go on April 4th for first reading. So this is the second time this commission has reviewed a rezoning in this area. The yellow is the case before you tonight. The orange area shows the boundary of the previous request that was reviewed on January 16th, known at the time as FY24-3-Zulu-Charlie. And as you can see on the, this is a shot from Google Earth, you've got the Wildflower Golf Course and Country Club community to the east. There's two developments to the north that we'll talk about later during the mobility review, talking about traffic impacts. So they're immediately adjacent, shown here in the green and blue. Of course, Adams is to the north. Old Waco's to the left. There's some property that adjoins that is currently undeveloped over here south of Walmart and running up towards Old Waco. And you've got some homes on acreage along Jupiter. And then you've got quite a bit of agricultural land, you know, to the west and to the south, and that's what this currently is. And last, there's a duplex community, the Wildflower Meadows community, that's here off of Blue Stem Boulevard. So some of the same photos from the previous request, the situation on the ground has not drastically changed other than, as you see in the lower right-hand corner, it is a little bit greener. And this is the view from Jupiter looking towards the general area where that emergency access gate would come in. But, you know, to the concerns that we've heard is, you know, Jupiter could not handle public traffic, and the road in this picture, you know, confirms that. So the background is, you know, the previous request was 136 acres. This is 92.65. The previous request was a mixed-use development with multifamily townhomes and single-family. This is only single-family one. The minimum lot size for our single-family one is 7,500 square feet, so that's the one of the larger, you know, least dense zoning districts that we have for residential, which will mean fewer homes. When we get into the conditions, we'll talk specifically about how many homes and when. And the applicant has provided a site plan that shows thoroughfares, the Pepper Creek drainage, and open space trails that would follow along with them. So we'll go to their site plan. And the first thing I will draw your attention to is the north arrow. This has been turned to the side so we can show as much detail on the screen as possible. So the thoroughfares that would be part of the applicant's responsibility to construct are this one running north and south, and then two out to Kegley to provide that connectivity. You have the emergency gate here that would connect to Jupiter. And again, this has been reworded and emphasized in the plan development conditions that access gate would remain closed. If this is not a through street, this is not for public traffic, that's only to be used in case of an emergency. The first responders, the fire police, would have the ability to open that if they needed to, if for whatever reason they were unable to get into the development off of the two primary entrances. Along the Pepper Creek Trail and the drainage channel you see running through, there's those bright green dashed lines. Those are trails that would be required to be constructed in along the floodplain and that open space, so that would provide that amenity for the community. And note that, you know, this some of this is carried over from the previous request, and the principle still applies that any development that comes in up here is going to have to comply with the city's thoroughfare plan. And in terms of them being able to construct this, whatever comes here would have to tie in to what's constructed so that there is that future connectivity, not just for this neighborhood, but for the whole vicinity. The surrounding areas I showed on the Google Earth, mostly agricultural zoning, cropland, homes on acreage. Mentioned the Wildflower Club. This is PD zoning, so it's in that cross-hatched area. the Wildflower Meadows is Office 1, which does allow the duplexes. The whole thing is zoned, but only half of it has been developed to date. And then, of course, you know, the Jupiter Drive side, not large agricultural lots, but certainly homes on acreage. But having the single-family zoning would be compliant with all of the surrounding zonings. So we'll compare the existing city thoroughfare plan, which is in the smaller image, with the proposed site plan that the applicant provided. So I'll walk you through the city thoroughfare, and then we'll compare that to the site plan. So there's a couple alignments shown as community collectors on the city's thoroughfare plan. One runs north and south here, and then there's two that run east-west. What the applicant has done is they have moved the alignment away from the property line to run through the middle of their development. They're showing a new thoroughfare here, and they're moving the one to the north. They're bringing that down to tie over to Tanglehead. Pending the approval of this case, that could trigger or would trigger thoroughfare plan amendments. We would update the maps on our website to reflect these new connections so that that can still be enforced, that the future development would tie into what's being built. As I mentioned, there's Jupiter with the emergency access. The Hogan Road is the connection down here. They're not proposing to construct that at this time. They simply don't own the property to make the connection out to Kegley. They do own the property up here to make those two connections. There's a plan development condition that single family one, they can get up to 300 lots with those two enhanced entrances. To go more than the 300, they would need a third connection. Whether that comes from here as development goes off to the west towards Old Waco, or if it comes off of Hogan Road and there's a future connection to either Kegley or again Old Waco down off of a future Hogan alignment, that's where that could come from. So we're not saying where that has to come from, just that the connection would have to be provided before more homes were allowed. Kegley Road widening, they're taking that to publish the bid on March 24th with the review and the contract being approved in April. So this may push the construction start a little bit to the right. Don't have a confirmed start because I don't think they have until they have the contractor on board that can say, yes, we can start on a particular date. That's going to say when Kegley Road is coming. But they are at the point that they are going to publish the bid, which 2 months ago we didn't have a clear answer on that. So the wheels are moving. No other capital improvement projects are proposed at this time, so there's no city plans to widen Hogan Road or to extend Tanglehead. Right now we're just working on Kegley Road in terms of this development. We know that there are other CIP projects going on in Temple. As far as the specific characteristics of those thoroughfares that are shown in orange here that the applicant would construct with their development, those collectors would have to be 66 feet of right-of-way. There would be either a 6-foot sidewalk on both sides a 5-foot sidewalk on both sides or a 10-foot shared use path on one side. So you're still getting the same amount of concrete for your walkers or your bikers. These two collectors will link, and this is some feedback that we heard from the commission, that it kind of doesn't make sense to say we need two connections so you don't get bottlenecked, but the plan development ordinance doesn't explicitly require that link. So that has been baked into the ordinance that, you know, the residents of this development will have access to one or both of those outlets to get in and out. And just giving folks a choice with traffic is always a good result. And then last, I mentioned on the Google Earth, and you see here, again, the dashed green lines for the trails for the green belt. That is both what they're proposing, and that's a requirement straight out of the Parks and Trails Master Plan, which is shown here on our thoroughfare plan slide. So they are compliant with the thoroughfare plan and the Parks and Trails Master Plan. While we're talking about roadways and mobility, I'll let you digest some of these numbers for a second. So So the estimated construction for Kegley, said they're taking this to bid at the end of March. Should award the contract late April sometime. And then assuming that they start construction, I would guess is probably going to be May, but don't quote me on that until we have a contract in place. 300 single family homes, according to the Institute of Traffic Engineers, would generate 2,829 trips. Kegley's carrying about 5,000 daily trips a day. And then remember those two townhome and apartment developments that I showed you earlier? Those are up here on the corner of Adams and Kegley. The Villages at Pepper Creek could be expected to produce 1,400 trips. And the Kegley townhomes with 175 dwelling units would generate 1,260. It's worth noting that both of those are under construction. Villages under construction, the townhomes have not started construction. So that traffic doesn't exist yet. We assume it's coming, but it's not here. So if we're going to look at the capacity of Kegley, you know, between 12 to 24,000 daily trips, that two lanes with the center turn lane, that yes, we're approaching capacity, but there is still capacity to add the homes here. And I'll keep reiterating this point. Future expansion that would add more homes is going to require those multiple connections, whether it's over to Old Waco or down or off a future Hogan. But it is compliant with our mobility review. And the future development plan shows this entire vicinity as residential neighborhood services, which is primarily new single family. That's what the applicant is proposing. You know, the future land use designation does allow for duplexes and quads and townhouses if they're located on a collector. And there's additional considerations and emphasis for pedestrian and bicycle facilities. So they're proposing single family, and they are providing both those green belt trails and the sidewalks on the collectors. So they are compliant with the future development plan. Existing sewer and water, there is some facilities in the area. And of course, as they begin building out the neighborhood, they would install the necessary connections. Those would be specifically reviewed and designed during the platting. But as you see here, there's a 15-inch sewer line that runs through the development. There's a nearby 24-inch line that runs along the creek. And there's two 12-inch water lines that, you know, may provide a starting point. So in terms of utilities, we are compliant with the utility map. To summarize, you know, the different categories we look at for these plan developments, it is compliant with all the categories, starting with the future development plan, going through the public facilities thoroughfare mobility master plan and the parks and trails master plan. We received a few notices, and thank you, Ms. Huey. She brought hers right before the meeting started and was able to add her to the map. I haven't added the numbers, though, so bear with me on that. So at this point, we sent out 29 notices. We've received four notices back in agreement. One inside the boundary was in disagreement. And then one received an email from a gentleman who lives in the Wildflower community. So that's over here on your screen. And of course, that disagreement is included in the packet that will go to council. If there were a supermajority to be triggered, then the disagreements outside that red boundary would not be calculated. They count, they're just not calculated. And the newspaper printed notice of the public hearing on March 7, 2024, in accordance with state law and our local ordinances. Staff recommends approval of the plan development rezoning from ag to single family one plan development, or as we abbreviate PDSF1, with the development site plan labels as Exhibit A, subject to the following conditions. Now, I'm not going to put all 16 conditions and read them to you verbatim, but I did summarize and pull out some of the key points here. So take a minute, you can skim through there while I have a drink of water. So number six is that emergency access point, and the wording specifically says it will remain closed except for use in an emergency. The collectors are that 66 minimum right away, which exceeds what our current code would require now. So they're giving us a little bit extra. residential driveways would be prohibited on those collectors, and they must interconnect. Number 9 shows those minimum sidewalks or the 10-foot shared use path. And whether that each road specifically gets 2.5s or 1.10, that's something that's going to be determined during the, there'll be a preliminary plat required. So I may have jumped ahead of myself, but number 4 up there at the top, the preliminary plat's going to show the basic street layout, the lot layout, any phasing plans of, you know, how this will come in as it gets developed. Regardless of the phasing plan, a maximum of 300 dwellings with the 2 improved entrances, as you saw in Exhibit A, those will be constructed so that you can get the connectivity in and out of the neighborhood. And that third improved entrance, where it may be, will be triggered if the plat is proposed that would run that number over 300. In other words, that plat could not be approved because it would be non-compliant with the zoning ordinance. So they would have to show that that connection had been constructed or was due to be constructed. That may mean that the adjacent properties would have to come forward for a rezoning and platting that with public review by this commission and council. So there's going to be additional oversight on what that third connection may look like because of the scope of this project being the 92 acres versus the larger acre that we saw before. And you know, the planning director may approve minor variations, but if there's significant deviations from the development site plan that we're showing you tonight, that's also going to require formal approval from this commission and the city council. So there's, again, there's a, you know, catch valve for, you know, additional oversight if there's changes to what's proposed and discussed tonight. And that concludes my presentation. I'll stand by if you have any questions.
Jason, I just have one question. If you go back to the transportation map, the note around the car count, remind me, oh no, it's on here, 2020. So this is, it's a 4-year-old data. Correct?
Correct.
That's the way to read this?
The annual counts are 2020, or excuse me, the annual counts were from 2022.
The red dots are urban
black
saturation. No,
the,
I'm
the
sorry.
The black ones, like for example up here on Adams, yeah, it says 28,722 in parentheses. So that's 2022 data. The red are what TxDOT calls urban saturation counts. So they have their stations on their roads where they do annual measurements. Every 5 years they do what they call an urban saturation. So they really go out and they measure everything everywhere all at once. So those are the red markers. And it gives us a little more data, but it's more labor intensive than they're able to do every single year. So we get that every 5 years. So you're right. That is 4-year-old data.
So the red dots are 4-year-old data.
The red dots are 4-year-old data.
The 5243 that's next to the 2829, that's the gray color. Could I understand that to be a black dot, black instead of gray?
I'd have to check, but I think that means that's an inactive station. It probably because it was moved somewhere, or because when that was, if the road construction was taking place at that time, they may not have had the data for it.
Yeah.
In 2020, what stage of construction was going on Kegley? Was it open in 2020, the whole way?
I don't think so. And I'm hearing people from the neighborhood that would know better than me say
I
no.
I mean, that's just 5,000 getting onto Adams from right there, not even using Kegley. Is that how I'm understanding it?
I think that would be a true statement.
And then who would maintain the gate on Jupiter? Like if somebody rammed through it, it broke, is that like an HOA?
Yeah, that'd be the applicant's HOA.
Jason, do I understand that the two connections to Kegley have to be interconnected in the subdivision to go beyond 300?
No, it just has to be connected to get them to the 300. So that
by 150 for one, summarize that for
right
me again.
The way our subdivision entry code or our subdivision entry standards work, a single entrance gets you 75 lots. A single improved entrance gets you 150, or two standard entrances. Two improved entrances, which would be here, can get you up to 300 lots. But what it doesn't say explicitly in the subdivision standards is that those two entrances have to interconnect. So in this case, we're specifying that they have to. I mean, it makes sense, but for the reassurance that
absolutely.
The traffic is going to flow, as Brian likes to say, belt and suspenders.
And just to confirm, this is Belton ISD? Or is this Temple?
Wildflower side's Temple, the other side's Belton.
Yeah, this is right on the dividing line. Thank you.
So Kegley is the divider?
The dividing line runs through Wildflower. I don't have a slide showing that, but I know from looking at the map that it's, for whatever reason, it's gerrymandered through there.
That's all. Thank you.
All right. Seeing none, this case does require a public hearing. We are going to open up the public hearing. If you wish to speak and are attending in person, please come to the podium. If you are viewing the meeting online, please first raise your hand. And please state your full name and city of residence for the record. I will say that we'll have a timer up, a three-minute timer for everybody, so everyone can be self-aware of how much time they have left. I'm assuming everybody on that signed in is wanting to speak on this one. Is that correct? There were some that left case numbers off, so I just wanted to make sure. I didn't want to omit anybody. We'll just run down this list. Forgive me if I accidentally mispronounce your name. But the first is Ken Johnson. Jason, can you put the timer up for me, please?
My name is Kenneth A. Johnson. I live at 4017 Sunflower in the Wildflower Homeowners Association area, along with the Country Club. I just wanted to make a couple of comments. Our concern is basically with Kegley. I don't think, at least in myself personally, I'm not against the development of property, which we need for the growth of Temple. I want to also say, just let you know that I was on the council that are the work group that did the Temple Comprehensive Plan in 2008. And Kegley was identified as a minor arterial, which according to ordinance is a four-lane road. Also, just to let know on traffic volume on Kegley in 2006 was 2,900 cars. So I believe that the estimates with regards to traffic are significantly understated. The challenge we have in Kegley right now with construction and everything else is we've had instances where we have had cars trying to cut through Wildflower in order to get to Kegley because of traffic either on West Adams or on the loop, and we have had cars backed up to the clubhouse halfway up Wildflower Drive. We have traffic coming in both directions because they use Google Maps and everything else to try and get around traffic jams on West Adams. So West Adams just comes over to Wildflower. We also have our friends in the duplexes that also use Wildflower to get back and forth because it's an easier way to get to the loop than it is trying to drive down Kegley. Now, if you refer to the city plan for 2004 on page 377, Kegley was supposed to be completed in December. I really, really think it's hard to believe that it's going to be completed in July of next year. We've been dealing this thing for almost 10 years. And I doubt if it's going to happen. Our concern is maintaining or limiting through traffic through our neighborhood. And what I mean by that is construction trucks, which we've already had to repair the entrance to Wildflower off the loop from the construction trucks that were coming through for Kegley, as well as for some of the construction trucks that will cut through from the apartments that are being built. So with that, we have a big concern about being able to get Kegley done, even though it's undersized, because it should have been four lanes. Both ends of Kegley are four lanes. It's four lanes until you get to West Adams. Midway is four lanes until you get to the railroad crossing. And then what we did for some reason is we made it two lanes and a turning lane, which back then may have thought to be sense, but now we're going to see 25,000 cars or more on a road that's only got two lanes. For that, I think we have to have some consideration as to how we control cross traffic and how these individuals are buying their homes, which they're going to pay a fair amount for and have a good place to live, have the ability to get in and on and off of their development and be able to access services and so forth within Temple.
Thank you, Mr. Johnson. I appreciate your time. Next, we have Pat Johnson.
I'm Pat Johnson. I live in Temple, Texas, also at 4317 Sunflower Lane, 4017 Sunflower Lane. Members of the commission, thank you for your service on this planning and zoning team. I know you have a lot of consideration to do. I echo what my husband said, and I am not against the growth of Temple, but rather encourage it. In this situation, I feel a little safety planning would be in order. Kegley Road was scheduled, and I emphasize was, to be completed by December 2024. Am I right? The only thing that is currently visible that has been done to Kegley Road from Bluestem on over to the railroad is maybe one or two potholes were filled in. We know that Kegley Road will be closed from where construction ended at Bluestem in phase two to the railroad tracks very soon. That will cut off traffic and cause it to be diverted into the Wildflower subdivision where we reside. If you give the green light on the rezoning property now, you open the gates for large, heavy equipment to go through Wildflower neighborhood, in addition to the traffic that was cut off to access the interstate through over on Kegley Road. This causes traffic through the neighborhood with Kegley being closed. It sounds like a nightmare that will be horrible and dangerous for everyone. If the first two phases of Kegley are any indication of completion of phase three, my money is still on it taking 5 years with traffic being terrible through Wildflower neighborhood. I think we can be smart about this. I'm not against the project. I'm not against that at all. I think with a little bit of planning and delay, let's do Kegley first. Let's delay this development when Kegley is finished, then address it with compliance from those people that are involved. And I hope that the developers come through with developing the roads that they have said before putting in houses. I hate to see that construction equipment come through Wildflower on Wildflower Lane and Sunflower Lane, which I don't live on that side of Sunflower. So in consideration of the traffic potential while construction of Kegley that is going on, and to just delay this planned development until that is completed. Thank you very much.
Thank you. All right, next we have Ruben, I'm sorry, is it Marsh? Marsh, sorry.
Hi there, I'm Ruben Marsh. I'm the realtor representing the developer. I live at 3908 South Paybridge Road here in Temple. I've lived in West Temple for 40 years. West Temple has grown especially a lot ever since 2305 was widened in 97. Texas has grown by 477,000 people just last year, and you'll continue to grow. Temple has jobs. New companies are moving to Temple. The Temple Economic Development Company has brought in lots of new people to Temple for new jobs. I've been told that they have around 600 acres available for new people to come. If we don't have homes for these people to live in, they're not going to come here. Also, currently, there's about 90,000 residents in Temple. And for Temple to get if Temple gets any larger, we could have different, up to 100,000 is where the cutoff point is for restaurants like Red Lobster, Cheddar's, and other major chains. Also, HEB owns 31 acres there on the corner of West Adams and Kegley Road there, and they tell me that for them to develop that, they need more rooftops for them to develop it. Here we go about Kegley Road. I understand 2 years. I travel Kegley Road also. I don't know. But then again, also, this development, probably won't be complete for 2 years or so before they even start selling homes. And if they start selling homes, it's not going to completely be filled up at that time period. The developer is also donating 5 acres of land to the city for a park there, which would complement the Wildflower area. Also, I live on Pea Ridge Road. Across the road from there, 60 acres there, and it's owned by a developer. And I assume that one day he's going to develop that. If I don't want that developed, I either need to buy that property or get used to the fact that West Temple's growing, or I need to move to Rosebud or Lot or somewhere like that. Also, there's also no grocery stores and things like that in those towns. Years ago, Ms. Albert Aldridge told me people were complaining that they did not want Lake Belton to be built in the early 50s. They were complaining that their people going to lose their homes, land. Just think, if they didn't approve that back then, where would we be at now? Also, Frank Mayburn, at the end in the late 50s, I-35 was going to come through Temple. It was going to go around Temple. Frank Mayburn raised money for it to snake through Temple. So that's why we have I-35 coming through Temple. If he didn't do that, we wouldn't be where we're at right now. So I'm just asking the planners to approve this plan so Temple would continue to grow. We'd have a place for people to live.
Next on the list is Ken. There you go. Yes, sir. Thank you.
Yes, my name is Kenneth McLaughlin. I live at 4410 Sunflower Lane. The gentleman just ahead of me, I guess, doesn't get what we're concerned about. We're concerned about safety. You know, first of all, if you, and I know you have, gone through Sunflower and Wildflower, I measured the other day between mailboxes, it's 30 feet. Now, that's including grass. So when you start taking all the traffic that's going to be coming from that new development, because I can tell you the exits coming from that new development are strategically close to Sunflower and Wildflower Lane. So guess where they're going to go? They're going to come up Sunflower and Wildflower, not go to Adams or not go to 35 on Kegley. They're not going to do that. I wouldn't. Number one, because there are stoplights at each end. If you come up through us, there's no stoplights to get, you can get to the access road without any stoplights. So who's going to use Kegley to go end to end? They're not going to do that. They're going to come right straight through us. You got 30 feet of road between the mailboxes. No sidewalks. People walk their dogs. Kids are out there playing. Golf carts cross those streets on a daily basis every day. It was built as a golf course community. That's what it was built as. And not a thoroughfare. And that's what we're going to have, guys. I mean, I'm not looking at anybody personal. I'm just saying the situation is what it is. You're going to put a thoroughfare on each street through Wildflower to accommodate that housing development. That's what's going to happen. And there's going to be accidents. There's going to be people hurt. It's going to happen. I'm just telling you. So I'm not real scientific. I'm not highly educated. But I know what I'm talking about. And to overlook safety, sir, for the sake of doing what you're trying to do, doesn't make sense to me. Just doesn't. I'm sorry. Just think about it, folks. I know development is, I lived in Las Vegas my whole life, except when I got here 9 years ago. And when I moved to Las Vegas, it was the whole entire valley of four towns was a quarter of a million. Now look at what Las Vegas is. You know, it's a quarter of a million plus itself. So I live through all that. I know what it is, and I know what happens. I've been there. So just consider what you're going to do if you allow that traffic to come through Wildflower on both those two streets. They fly through there now, and the construction vehicles, you know, they fly through there. There's a 90-degree corner on Sunflower, and people, you can't get by there hardly with two cars. You can't do it. So I just consider it, think about it, and thank you for your time.
Thank you, Mr. Waffle. Next is Jimmy and Patty Phillips.
Good Patty Phillips, 1320 Daisy Lane, Wildflower Country Club. I'm definitely against our neighborhood becoming a thoroughfare, which it never was designed to be, to have all of this traffic. And I watch it every Friday. Friday is like a zoo. They come through from the loop, and they're all out-of-towners because they have their GPS, and here they come, you know. And they come two at a time, straight down Wildflower Lane, as fast as they can go. And I'm riding in my golf cart to try to slow them down. And they, you know, I get the signs with their hands and the words from their mouths and all that, but I'm trying to correct it, you know, safety for our neighborhood. But I'm not against development either. That's fine. We're building so many things in this town. I don't know where people are going to come from to live in these places or pay for it. But I do think that we're putting the cart before the horse because the road is not completed for Kegley Road. And it's going to be probably when pigs fly, about 5 to 10 years before it'll be ready. So when it's ready and that pig is flying, then build all the houses you want to. But I say no, absolutely no.
Thank you, Mrs. Phillips. The common theme so far has kind of been Kegley related. If the rest of those that are wishing to speak regarding Kegley, I would ask that we maybe try to pinpoint some more topics towards the development proposal itself. They're understood and they're heard. It's just at this point it's becoming a little bit repetitive, which is understandable. It's a valid concern. I'm gonna list the rest of the names, of course, but if it's still just more Kegley discussion, I please ask that you acknowledge that as well. Next on the list is Mr. Jim Vaughn.
I'm Jim Vaughn. I live at 4121 Sunflower, and I've got just a word to say about Kegley. I've been dealing with Kegley for 45 years, building on the south side of town, Canyon Creek, the cliffs, all through there, building also at the lake. So you came down Kegley Road, and I can't tell you how many times I've heard different administrations say, tomorrow, it's on the agenda, we got the money, blah, blah, blah. And it doesn't happen. It's just kind of happening now. So that's why you find so people are so skeptical about it. Now, getting away from Kegley Road, my concern is there's been 99% conversation about getting people in and out of that development. There's been little or no conversation, except from comments from the Wildflower people, about once they hit Kegley, where do they go and what do they do? That's the sticking point. All of it's going to be funneled to Wildflower Drive. At one time, Hogan Road was shown that master concept to go from Kegley over to the service road. I noticed that's not there anymore. So that presents a problem. I mean, we're trying to be good stewards of our community, and of course we expect y'all, and y'all are, good stewards of our community and town. But you've got to use a little forethought on this, is where does all that siphon into? It siphons into about 200 yards of Kegley Road. And there, the only way to get out of there, not many people go south, some do, and some will go north, but predominantly they'll go through Wildflower on Wildflower, hit the service road, hit Loop 363, and then disperse from there. So I see a big quagmire there. And once it gets started and once it gets approved, it gets real difficult to change the direction of that train. So I ask that y'all consider carefully, not just the development. I've developed some homes and built a lot of homes. I've built probably 45 or 50 homes in Wildflower. I'm not against development. I'm against, as Abe reiterated, what do you do with that funneling effect all going to Wildflower and Sunflower? Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Baum. Next on the list is Debbie Huey.
Debbie Huey, Sam Huey, my husband. We've lived there at 6212 Jupiter for 32 years. We own. I asked Jason to put this up so I could show everybody. This is our property right here. We have the 10 acres that adjoin this property here. Our concern is this emergency access easement. Now y'all are saying it's gonna have a lock, click, whatever kind of lock there. These are gonna be the roads in this subdivision. What is gonna lock on this end? Because we all know that the drainage channels are not supposed to be used for hunting, motorcycles, go-karts, or anything of that nature, but they are used for that. So if there's not a lock on both ends and there's zero access to that, that's what we're gonna see right next to our property. There's no space that he has allowed here between our property and the emergency access easement. Zero space. It's right, better routed up to our fence line. There's no requirement for them to put up any kind of privacy structure for our property for sanity reasons, for noise reasons, and because our barbed wire fence is right there and back here. So we own, actually, Jupiter is on our property. The city has a right of way, but we own to across the street, and we own to this house is being part of it behind us. We own kind of 2/3 of the street down that way. Hindsight's 20/20. When we bought it, we should have fenced from property line to property line, but we didn't, and then we were annexed. So what is our guarantee here that there's not going to be the traffic that's going to be used here, be it kids playing or motorcycles, whatever, that this is going to be an opportunity for a funneling unless there's a lock and a way that they cannot get on there? Because this drainage up here has a lock on it and a gate, and cars and motorcycles or whatever, hunters, go around and travel the drainage channel and do what they want to do. An officer was called out for rapid fire, and when I talked to him outside, I said, if you'll just drive that berm there, and he said, my car's not made to drive on the dirt. So.
Your 3 minutes is
up. Pardon?
Your 3 minutes is.
That's fine. I don't care. So, I could say a whole lot more, but thank y'all very much.
Thank you, Mrs. Huey. Yeah, I'm sorry for not being able to read handwriting very well. Last name is looks like Serena. Is it Srena or Spena? Keyah. Oh, sorry. Okay. Okay. Sorry. Y'all are together? Y'all are six. Okay. I didn't have an. Okay. Number six. And that's Taylor? Perfect. All right. And then last name is Tally?
First of all, commissioners, thank you very much for your service. I've been there 3 years, chairman. I know sometimes it's difficult. In fact, I lost a friend because I voted against one of my neighbors. But I hope you don't do that with us. I hope you present a positive thought in what has already been presented. I live on Wildflower. I know what they're talking about. But the issue to me is what Pat Johnson said, is I'm not opposed to it. Maybe others are, but I'm not opposed to it. I'm opposed to it until Kegley is finished. And that's all I'm saying. So I hope you put that in your report or whoever takes the transcripts. Thank you very much.
Thank you. That concludes the list. Is there anybody else that would like to come speak at the podium prior to us closing the public hearing? Yes, sir.
Over here.
I'm Johnny Robinson. I live at 510 South Kegley Road. And my concern is the same as what they're saying about the traffic on Kegley. But I do notice that the plat has been changed from the 94 from the 100 and whatever it was before. And it left.
Being that he is here, Ray, have those already been rezoned or?
No, sir, they have not.
They have not, okay. So that'll be a topic for a future meeting. The other question I had was Kegley Road is going to be completed all the way to 35 as one project. Is that correct?
Yes, that is correct.
Okay. Because I had read something somewhere where it's talked about dividing it back into two. That was all I wanted to know.
Thank you. Yes, ma'am. Cool.
Kim Fort, 5108 Sunflower Lane. I think if we think about this, the Wildflower Country Club was developed as a country club. In other words, lots of golf carts are going in and out of the streets. There was no development thought of for sidewalks or golf carts to have free access. And I think the problem comes in right very close to Kegley, where Paintbrush is, and number one goes into number two, and the golf carts have to literally enter the street, Sunflower, and then wind their way over to the golf course. Again, I don't think they developed it. I'm not sure, I don't have any insight into what they were thinking, but just with the traffic, I don't think they were thinking that the traffic would accommodate both golf carts and cars, vehicles. So I'd just like y'all to take that into consideration because there are quite a few golf carts that run around in the neighborhood. To my knowledge, it's not illegal for them to do that. So you're going to have mixing of vehicles, very dangerous, with golf carts. And I do see kids driving around in the golf carts. So that's probably illegal and something that needs to be held accountable with the parents. But for adults that are driving, that's going to create a very dangerous situation. Thank you.
Thank you. One last call for public comments. Is anybody online, Jason?
Seeing BJ Little from Truly Engineering, Lexi England from Kimley Horn. I know Miss England is for the Nexus rezoning case.
Okay. With that,
Let me type a message in the chat.
We have one more in the back? Okay, I'm sorry. Yes, sir.
Yeah. Let me just add a little context to.
Please come to the podium.
Thank you. Let me just add a little context to. Kegley and what was addressed a moment ago about golf.
Give us your name and address.
Oh,
I'm sorry.
Jim Vaughn, 4121 Sunflower, Wildflower Country Club. As I say, I've been dealing with Kegley Road for 45 years coming and going. But at one time, I officed about where Martha Tyrock's home is. It was a little farmhouse. And the way you got to it is from Kegley through a little wooden bridge and then over to the farmhouse. Well, there's no little bridge there anymore because as development happened upstream, it washed all that stuff out. So that's why the golf carts are having to come around the corner off of Paintbrush and onto Sunflower and then turn back into number two. I mean, that's one of those inconvenient scenarios that happened years after the planning, but it seemed to me like things like that are getting gnarled up with the overall deal about first and foremost is the streets tunneling into Kegley and how to move them about Kegley. You got all those apartments, you got those homes coming up, and I think some prior planning is definitely needed. Thank you.
All right. With with that, we will close the public hearing. Before we make a motion, I would like to tell the panel, or tell the gallery that, you know, we are a recommendation board. And so either way that we vote tonight, either to recommend or not to recommend, the ultimate vote lands with council. So you'll also have an opportunity to go to the council meetings. I think there'll be two of them for you guys to express y'all's comments and considerations as well. But with that, I will entertain a motion if there's no more questions from the commission.
A couple of questions. One, again, when is Kegley planned to be completed?
Jason?
So that is going to depend on the actual construction date. The duration that I've heard from our public works engineering is it's going to be an 18-month project. So assuming it starts in May, it's probably going to be past the July that I had on the slide. But, you know, again, that's going to depend on when they get that contract in place.
Actually, almost 2 years then, something like that.
I would agree with that.
Secondly, has the developer considered any other routes that the construction trucks can go through and so forth to be able to reduce any go through from the
away from
workers?
Wallflower Lane? Other than mandating them having to go down Kegley, I'm not sure. Can
are we talking the construction for this development and the construction
yes.
for the capital improvement project?
This development.
I think I would defer to the applicants for what their construction plan is.
Lena Chate, Belton Engineering. So there should be no reason for the construction trucks to be using Wildflower. It will be coming through Kegley, and keep in mind that construction equipment will be moving on site one time initially when the project starts, and then when the project ends, they'll be leaving the site. So that will not be a daily construction traffic.
It seems like, you know,
you're talking about heavy construction equipment, or you're talking about daily?
Just ongoing work.
Just a reminder for those in the gallery, we've got someone at the podium speaking. They had respect for you guys while you were speaking. Please do the same for them. Go ahead, Judy. I'm sorry. Or Commissioner Morales.
Don't regular construction workers and so forth?
So we can definitely coordinate that with them for no one to be using the Wildflower and just come through Kegley. That could be coordinated.
But you haven't worked that out at this point?
We don't even have a preliminary plat. We don't have a contractor for the job yet, but when time comes.
Thank you.
Right, the one that's going out to bid is going to be the whole thing combined all the way down to where it ties into Charter Oak and Midway.
I think one of my biggest issues is the Jupiter Drive gate. I don't know. I mean, I understand it's a click gate, but again, mm-hmm. somebody opens that gate, leaves it open, people are going to use it. I know that we can say the construction trucks are going to go down Kegley, but as soon as this project starts, they're also going to go down Jupiter, because they're going to be coming from Old Waco from job sites over there, coming off of 317. And again, just having, I understand the need for extra entrances and safety. It's just hard for me to wrap my head around that being a good idea. Like, maybe if the gate was where the road ends down there, not up on the edge. Because again, Jupiter Drive, you just can't drive down it. Now, I mean, maybe if the developer wanted to agree to take that road and redo it all the way to Old Waco, that's something else we could talk about, but that's just my opinion. We're
probably going to take longer than 2 years. But I think that's everything I have to say.
One more question. What impact would it have for them, for the developer, to postpone until this is completed?
The applicant, speak on my behalf.
Did you understand the question? Yes, correct.
So I do want to add that even when the zoning gets approved, this project is going to take 5 to 6 years for it to be completed. And that is going to, Kegley will be well completed before this project is even completed. 300 lots will take 5 to 6 years.
But would it impact the whole project if we have to delay it for a period of time?
It will negatively impact this. And then yes, it will negatively impact the project. And we do have demand for housing today.
We agree for that. We're just concerned about safety, as they've talked about, and trying to see what impact it would have, because we do need more housing, but we also want to consider our neighbors at this point.
Correct. And that's why this we came back with a lot less dense proposal than what was originally proposed, because we did listen to the neighbors, we did listen to the concerns, and we revisited the proposal, and this is where we think it would be a good medium for everybody.
And we appreciate that very much. Yes.
Well, at least the hope here is that the construction for Kegley for phase 3 and 4 is about to start.
Yeah.
So at this point, I understand that the duration is 18 months. So, yeah, that takes, instead of 18 months, 24 months, even 2.5 years. We're still talking about 300 lots that will not be developed all within the first 2 years.
I think if you'll just stay there, and I've kind of waited, and I'll hold it to 3 minutes, I promise, just like everyone else did. My first point is what you were just mentioning. How long would it take for the dirt work, getting the process ready, with the understanding Wildflower is a little bit of a mute point, and I'm not here to offend or hurt anyone's feelings or lose friends or any of that type of thing. But Kegley is a private subdivision, and if they don't want the traffic, then they need to work with the city on figuring out how to keep the traffic out of their community. So I'm going to call that a mute point, because yes, it's a safety issue, but that's something a community needs to figure out. Kegley is the piece of my mind that says if it's going to take 2 years, 3 years to get the dirt work completed, and I'm not putting words in your mouth, I need you to validate my words, how long will it take to get the plat or the amount of land ready to even start roads and all that information?
So this one will be definitely built into phases. And realistically, we will have probably 75 lots in phase one. And the first thing that has to happen is a preliminary plat. And for planning and to get a preliminary plat in place, it's going to be what we account for is about 8 to 12 months. And that's not because it takes that long through the city, but internally it does take that long for us to get our traffic engineer on board, geotechnical studies, do all the planning, figure out how, where the parks, trails, drainage, there's just so much involved before it even is presented to the city for approval. So we look at it as 8 to 12 months for preliminary plat, another 4 to 6 months for final plat for phase one. That is the first 75 lots. And then, so we are at least 18 months out. And then it does take about 8 months, 6 to 8 months for phase one to be developed and for lots to be ready to sell. So you're talking at least, if everything falls in place on our end and we have everything ready, with our internal consultants and everything goes through smooth, we're still talking at least 2 years to have the first lot ready to sell.
I don't have anything else. Thank you for your feedback.
Thank you.
motion we approve FY24-17-ZC as recommended by staff.
Second.
Got a motion for approval as presented by Commissioner Weaver and a second by Commissioner Walker. May we have a vote, please?
Yes. Commissioner Morales?
Aye.
Commissioner Walker?
Aye.
Commissioner Jurassic?
Aye.
Commissioner Weaver?
Aye.
Commissioner Carney?
Aye.
Chair Marshall?
Aye.
The vote is unanimous and the motion carries.
All right, we will move now to item number 6, FY24-15.
Can we call a pause just to allow them to get out so we can...
Sure. All right.
Just as a side note for those exiting, we're going to continue on with our business meeting, so please hold it down in the hallway.
We're going to move on to item number 6, which is FY24-15-ZC. Hold a public hearing to discuss and recommend action on a rezoning request from two-family dwelling to neighborhood service on 0.5165 acres, legally described as Lot 2, Block D, Bellevue Edition, subdivision addressed as 1911 West Avenue H. And this case will be presented by Planner Shelby Smith. Thank you, Shelby.
Shelby.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman and members of the commission. So starting off, we have the applicant is the Willow School for rezoning from two family to neighborhood service. We do have the applicants here today, so just want to acknowledge their presence. And then also on the screen, we have the scheduling for the Planning and Zoning Commission meeting, and then also the first reading and the second reading for the city council meetings. So here on the screen, really the first one here is a vicinity map of the property, and then we also have an aerial map here. Again, this is for a rezoning of two family to neighborhood service for a proposed child care center, an elementary or a Montessori school. And this is already platted. It's in the Bellevue Edition subdivision. Also, just for more context, this building used to be the Seventh-day Adventist Church, so it was a religious use before. All right, so this screen is really a survey of the existing conditions submitted with the building permit. We don't have a specific site plan for this, but just wanted to include this for context. And with the Parks and Trails Master Plan, it does require a neighborhood connector trail. However, there are already sidewalks that are existing. All right, so here are some pictures of the site. Again, this previous building use was for a church building, so you can see the actual site from here. The bottom picture is the corner of 39th Street and West Avenue H, and then you also have the 39th Street view as well. All right, so here's more, Okay, so on the left, there's a picture of what it looks like from the north view of the site. So this is zoned as office and general retail. Some of those offices include a attorney office and also a certified public accountant's office as well. And then on the south, it's residential and commercial uses that are zoned two family. To the west of the property, it's planned development offers zoning. And then to the east of the property, it's zoned neighborhood service. And some of the businesses that are existing there are the Best Little Hair House and City Creek Dental. So in terms of the zoning map and the zoning for neighborhood service, this is compliant. We did do a development review committee on March 4th. There were no rezoning issues identified in that review. And we have determined that this property is appropriate for neighborhood service as a proposed Montessori school. It's also compliant with the future development plan. This is just more information about the urban residential future development category, which is what this property is considered. And then also neighborhood service is supported by the future development plan. Okay, this is just the existing water and sewer map. So you can see that there are utilities available with an 8-inch sewer line to the north of the property and also to the a 6-inch sewer line to the west of the property, as long as well as water services to the west boundary of the property and then also to the north of the property. And the facilities that are currently existing are already connected to the building. In terms of the thoroughfare plan and trails, so street frontage is classified as major arterial, and there is a 6-foot sidewalk requirement. Again, there are sidewalks that are already in place. And this is just a comparison of the current zoning, the two family use compared to the neighborhood service. The Montessori school would be considered a child care, daycare center, and also an elementary school. So you can just see here the comparison of those two different zonings and those uses. We also have the dimensional standards with the two family and the neighborhood service as a comparison as well. Okay, in terms of the public notification and property owner notification, there were 21 notices that were sent out. We received 2 notices returned in agreement. You can see that on the notification map here labeled A. And we did not receive any notices returned in disagreement. And this was published in the newspaper on March 7, 2004. Excuse me, 2024. In terms of compliance, it's compliant with the future development plan, also the compatible with surrounding uses and zoning. Public facilities are currently available, and it's also compliant with the thoroughfare plan. In terms of the Temple Heights Neighborhood Planning Development, or excuse me, Neighborhood Planning District, it is compliant to support a commercial edge zone in that area. So overall, staff recommends approval of the rezoning from two family to neighborhood service. All right, and I'll pause for any questions.
Thank you, Shelby. Commissioners, any questions or comments?
Debbie, is this a franchise or is this someone local that's wanting to repurpose the building? Can you give us some details around that possibly?
So we do have the applicant here.
Oh, thank you. And thank y'all for your patience getting through that last case. Sorry, I didn't realize we had someone from another case that y'all had to wait for, so thank you.
That's okay. Hello. My name's Taylor Jackson. My business partner, Kaya Spence, is over there. We are not a franchise. We are just two parents who wanted another option for our children. I will be the director. I am currently a special education teacher in Belton ISD. I am finishing up my doctorate in leadership from Baylor. So, you know, that's just kind of where we decided we wanted to go. Both of my children attended Montessori, so we love, you know, we just love Montessori education, so that's why we chose to do that. But we are not a franchise.
Thank you.
Should I stay up here or? No, okay.
If you're gonna speak during the public comment section, you can stay up there, yes.
Do you have any additional comments you wanted to share?
Or you can just stay now.
Okay. We are hoping to open for children 6 to 7 years old, which is why the elementary part is included. We have put almost $200,000 of renovations into the building. We completely redid the sewage, right? It was very old and had breakage and stuff like that, so we replaced that. New HVAC systems. We've really put a lot of heart and money into this in hopes to kind of better the community. So that's that.
Thank you.
Thank you. Any other questions, Commissioner? All right. Well, this does require a public hearing. We'll now open the public hearing. If you wish to speak and are attending in person, please come to the podium. If you're viewing the meeting online, please virtually raise your hand. Please state your full name and city of residence for the record.
I'll take this opportunity to note that there's no members of the public online right now.
Thank you, Jason.
Okay. Good evening, gentlemen and ladies and gentlemen. My name is Edward J. Santana, and you sent me a letter to my house. I live in 810 South 39th Street, and I totally support the Willow School because I think Temple needs more schools that direct the children when they are in the early stage. As you know, everybody knows that when you teach a kid, a girl or boy, you teach them correctly since they are little. When they grow up, they will never depart for that good instruction that you gave them, directions and good role model example. So I'm totally supporting 100% or 110% this school. If you approve this rezoning, I think it's going to be beneficial for this great city. And I appreciate that you consider that the real good. And I think it's going to be good for the future. The children are the future, you know. Kids are the future. Yeah. So everybody probably knows about that. Mm-hmm. So thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you.
And I'm done with it. Thank you.
Thank you.
All right, seeing no other public hearing comments, we'll close the public hearing. And if there aren't any more questions or comments from the commission, I'll entertain a motion. I've got a motion by Commissioner Morales for approval and a second by Commissioner Weaver. May we have a vote? Please,
yes,
Kathy?
Yes. Commissioner Morales?
Aye.
Commissioner Walker?
Aye.
Commissioner Jurasic?
Aye.
Commissioner Weaver?
Aye.
Commissioner Carney?
Aye.
Chair Marshall?
Aye.
The vote is unanimous and the motion carries.
I got to make sure you're in the minutes on every case.
Please do.
Since it's your last one.
Thank y'all for your commitment to the community. It's greatly appreciated.
Yes. Excited about y'all's opportunity. All right. We're going to move to item number 8. FY-24-18-ZC, hold a public hearing to discuss and recommend action on a rezoning request from agriculture to general retail on 15 acres, part of a tract known as Bell County Tax Appraisal District Identification Number 15498 in the PM Mercer Survey Abstract 553 and addressed as 6944 Airport Road. In this case, will be presented by Mr. Jason Deckman.
All right, good evening, Chair and Commissioners. It's good to see you again. So this is out on Airport Road. We'll skip right ahead to the photos. We'll draw your attention to the top two photos showing that, you know, it's a home on acreage, so the rezoning is going to pull 15 acres out of about a 20-acre parcel. And you can see the home from a couple angles in the top, as well as the fire station and the airport are nearby. The lower right corner shows a better picture of the adjacent fire station number 8 and the training facility. And then the priority charter school is located across the road on the south side, and you see that on the lower left photo. I've also got two photos showing the private road that enters into the development. And that's kind of catty corner across from Leitner Lane. So Leitner Lane is here, and that's the private road that enters into where the home is now. So you see in the aerial photo, that's the private road. The school's over here and the fire station to the north. But otherwise, it's fairly undeveloped land that surrounds it. So it's 15 acres out of that larger tract. And you can see where through the tree line, kind of where that remnant tract would be. The applicant has asked for straight rezoning to general retail. They've indicated that at least a portion of it would be for a convenience store, the gas station. And as we know, most convenience stores have alcohol sales. And part of our code regulates alcohol sales within a certain distance from the school. We have a slide for that that we'll show you later. This is a straight rezoning, so there's not a site development plan or anything binding. We do have a concept that we'll show you in terms of distance from the school, but a plat would be required, and they would divide this up into lots, and that's where we would review the size of the lots, any drainage, the need for utilities or access management, because Airport Road is a major arterial. It's a TxDOT facility, so they would have to get TxDOT approval. There's no existing entrances there, so they would have to work through that process prior to building. The future land use does show it as employment mixed use, which is for regional serving mixed use employment, a mixture of industrial, office, retail, residential, or service uses. So a convenience store would fit in that retail service category, but provides opportunities for larger development. So there's 15 acres. There's certainly opportunities for other development to come into this property. But it's with an auto-oriented character, and being located on the State Highway 36, that makes sense. We did run this past the fire chief and the director of the airport. Neither had any objections. The airport director noted that you didn't need permits if they were going to raise a sign, that you know that would have to comply with FAA regulations, although he doubted that they would even try to build a sign that high. But they had no objection, so it is compliant with the future land use, future development plan. In terms of Highway 36 being a major arterial, so they would need the TxDOT approval for the entrances. And there's a connector trail. They would be required to install some type of sidewalk or the trail when they bring in the subdivision plat. In terms of how much traffic we were talking about on that arterial, I have a slide for that. So Airport Road is a four-lane highway with a center turn lane. According to our comprehensive plan, that could carry 20 to 40,000 daily trips. And if you see the map on the right there, the nearest count station, which was that 2020 count to Commissioner Carney questions earlier, that's a few years out of date, but it was 15,000. Closer to Outer Loop down there at Research and Hilliard, where that existing gas station is, that CEFCO on the corner, 21,000. Closer up towards the airport as you're leaving town, it declines or decreases to 14,000. So, yes, Airport Road is carrying a lot of traffic, but looks like there's plenty of capacity. The convenience store, so the ITE that we do these trip generation calculations bases residential on dwellings, bases some of the retail calculations on square feet, but gas stations are based on the fuel position. So one of those little pump kiosk devices counts as one position. And they've indicated that either what they're working on with their concept right now, they're looking at six gas and then three diesel, and there'd be two separate, you know, overhead covers for those pump stations. Based on nine fuel positions, estimated that this development, and I'm going to use a very specific word, that would attract 2,386. Gas stations are kind of unique because they're not built to be a destination, other than Buc-ee's, but they're an outlier. And there may be some trips that are generated from the nearby neighborhood to run over there and pick up a six-pack or maybe some duct tape, or maybe we just want to go get tacos, and there's a gas station right there. The majority of the traffic that number is referring to, it's the traffic that they're catching come down the highway. They're building a gas station there because it's a high traffic road. That's their customers. In terms of the transportation planning, thinking about safety, there's an existing CEFCO down here on the south side of the road. Another gas station on the north side of the road would reduce the need for people to make left turns. And left turns are one of the most dangerous things you can do on the road in terms of turning, moving, switching lanes. So this minimizes the need for left turns. So you could get your coffee coming in or going out, get your gas, get your beer, what have you. And that 2386 is a doable number on this roadway. There's other retail uses could be. I included those in the packet. But at this point, there's no telling, you know, what it may be. Could it be building sales? Could it be nail salon? Could it be office? It could be any number of things. So there's some kind of best guess included in the packet. But I did get an answer from the school, and this was not in your packet, so I apologize. I didn't have an answer from the charter school until this morning. They serve 125 students. So based on the AM peak hour for the schools, anywhere from 94 to about 118 trips in the morning. That's the parents dropping off the kids, the employees, the teachers coming daily, about 300. So, you know, much smaller generator in comparison to the overall traffic on the road or what, you know, retail uses may come in here on top of the convenience store. So it is compliant from our mobility review. Mentioned that, you know, future utilities would be determined during platting. Here's what's on the ground now. There's a 24-inch water main across the road they would have to bore to, and there's a pressurized force main, so that's going to require some engineering to figure out how they're going to tie to, you know, either the main or a 10-inch line to the north or an 8-inch line to the south. I'm not a civil engineer, but that's something that our Public Works Department will review during the platting stage. We provided some comparison of uses between the existing agricultural zoning and future general retail. Two takeaways here. One, there's a lot more uses allowed in the GR than the agriculture. And the alcohol beverage store. So sales of beer and wine in general retail are permitted by right. If they wanted to do a liquor store, that would require a conditional use permit, and that would come back before this commission. But the alcohol sales is subject to Chapter 4, that you cannot have sales of alcohol within 300 feet of the school. So we asked our mapping department to show us what that 300-foot buffer would look like. It's shown here. It's measured from property line to property line. And depending on where you drop your ruler, you've got about 160 to 170 feet of right-of-way going down Airport Road. So there's another chunk of the subject property that would fall into that 300. So they would have to make a decision to place the convenience store someplace that it's not going to trigger that compliance with that 300-foot. And this is the draft concept. This is not binding. But if they put the gas station down in the corner, they could do it in such a way that they're outside that 300-foot radius. So I don't know if Lexi England was their applicant. She had dropped off. And I think we've got Chris here. So thank you all for your timeliness on getting this back to us. For the commission to understand the impact of the convenience store and the distance. They've moved it about as far from the school as you could get. So to summarize, it is compliant with all the categories that we evaluate against for change of zoning. We sent out 5 notices to adjacent property owners. Some of those notices all went to the same owner, so they may own different parcels, but it's a single owner. We've received no notices back either in agreement or disagreement. And the newspaper printed notice of the public hearing on March 7th, 2024, twice apparently. I always catch a typo in my presentations. Today is no exception. In closing, staff recommends approval of the rezoning request from agricultural to general retail, and I'll stand by if you have any questions.
Thank you, Jason. Commissioners, any questions or comments?
Correct.
So we don't need to worry about like a back fence or anything?
Not at this point. I think that's something that, our normal buffer, even though the Honeycutts are the owner, and they're working with the applicants on this, regardless of the ownership, the code still requires that the non-residential uses provide the screening from the residential. But that's going to be determined and reviewed during the building permit review. Again, not being a PD, we don't have the site plan to where we could make a PD ordinance condition, but we do have the code that simply requires it when non-residential commercial retail butts against the homes. So it's still there.
Jason, the only thought I had is looking at the map, it does look like they're going to request 2 entrances off of Airport Road.
Mm-hmm.
My pause was going to be, surely we're not going to try to put something across from Leitner with the last conversation we had about Leitner being unsatisfactory in current state, and then we just rezoned that area. So I'm excited to see that, and I hope that the applicant and the developer will keep that in mind, that there's already a planned development going in across the street without Leitner being upgraded. So if there's any way not to add additional connectivity right across from Leitner, would be greatly appreciated. Especially for those area, for those people out in that area. That's all
and
I thought I had.
I'll reiterate, this isn't binding. This
understood.
Is a draft concept, but one of the things that we did mention during the DRC process was, one, the TxDOT approval, but two, the access management and the spacing, knowing that there would be future retail, to have the minimum number of entrances, and then there would be a shared access easement, amongst all those developments, so that we don't have situation similar to, say, 31st Street, where there's
agreed.
A driveway every 10 feet. So this would limit that access. Mr. Chandler.
Can you just let them know that Leitner will be improved?
Yeah, and Leitner's still going to be improved as part of that planned development that's coming in. Yeah. There, that.
It's conditioned. So
yeah, that is a requirement that
I'm not going to go down the path of Kegley and Lightner, but you understand my thought there. Oh, good. Okay, that does help validate
literally.
That. And I can appreciate that, Brian. Thank you.
Brock versus Mush.
Yeah. Valid. Thank you, Brian.
All right. This case does require a public hearing. We'll now open the public hearing. If you wish to speak and attend in person, please come to the podium. If you're viewing the meeting online, please virtually raise your hand. Please provide your full name and city of residence for that record.
Nobody online but us.
Seeing none in person, we'll close the public hearing. And if there's no further questions or comments, I'll entertain a motion.
I make a motion we approve FY2418ZC as recommended by staff.
Second.
Got a motion by Commissioner Weaver for approval and a second by Commissioner Carney. May we have a vote, please?
Yes. Commissioner Morales?
Aye.
Commissioner Walker?
Aye.
Commissioner Jurosik?
Aye.
Commissioner Weaver?
Aye.
Commissioner Carney?
Aye.
Chair Marshall?
Aye.
The vote is unanimous and the motion carries.
All right. And we're going to move on to item number 9, FY-24-7-PLT. Consider and take action on the final plat of the lofts at Blackland Ranch. With the developer requested exception to the UDC section 8.3.1A.6 related to park fees for a 20.016 acre 22 lot 5 block 3 track residential subdivision situated within the maximum Marino survey abstract number 14, generally located east of South 5th Street, west of the Georgetown Railroad alignment, and 2,000 feet south of Blackland Ranch Road, addressed at 4815 South 5th Street. In this case, will be presented by Principal Planner, Mr. Mark Baker.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, members of the Commission. And tonight is Planning and Zoning Commission is reviewing this as final authority, which includes the review of the exception to public park fees. So just a little bit of background. Again, this property is due south of the Blackland Ranch subdivision, which, as you may remember, was approved back in April of 2023. But tonight is what's before you is the lofts at Blackland Ranch. These are two separate developers, but are within the TMED T South zoning. And so this is a 20-acre, 22-lot, 5-block, 3-track subdivision, which includes retail, townhome, and fourplex uses. The plat is consistent with the TMED T South zoning, which was approved back in 2023. And the smallest lot in this case is approximately 19,000 square feet, with the largest being 1.2 acres. And so this property is within the Temple Independent School District. Our Development Review Committee reviewed this back in December 21st of 2023, and it was deemed complete and filed on March 6th. And just looking at the picture, referencing back to Blackland Ranch subdivision, phase one was before you in April of last year. There is an anticipated future phase two with that. That has not been submitted. As part of the lofts will be the continuation of King's Crossing, which the Blackland Ranch subdivision did plat. And again, this will continue that alignment, which will curve toward Waters Dairy with the intersection of South 5th Street. And this is the final plat for the lofts at Blackland Ranch. As you can see, King's Crossing makes that bend to make that connection with Waters Dairy. Following consistent with the Blackland Ranch, will include a 6-foot and a 10-foot sidewalk. There are plat notes on the lofts at Blackland Ranch subdivision. There's also included two trail easements, which will connect to the Georgetown Railway Trail, and those were included with this plat. I also want to point out the yellow star at the King's Crossing connection on the northern boundary of the lofts. Just kind of show you a picture. This is looking from the Blackland Ranch Phase 1 subdivision looking toward the lofts. And what I want to point out is the staking, which includes the right-of-way for King's Crossing, as well as the alignment and continuation of the sidewalk, which are for a 10-foot and 6-foot sidewalk. I don't normally show pictures with the subdivision presentations, but I did want to show that this was well staked out, and I just have an arrow pointing to the South Fifth Street and Waters Dairy intersection. So the water layout does include the continuation of a 6-foot water line, which will serve for this subdivision, as well as a 6-inch on South Fifth Street, and the wastewater layout, which shows the 6-inch sewer line also in King's Crossing. I want to go back that I wanted to point out also, since this subdivision does include a number of retail townhouse and quad type uses, the retail would be fronting along South Fifth Street, and these larger lots do include the fourplex as well as the townhouse in the interior portion of the property, and does include alleyways as well as the connection or access onto the local streets, Rock Rose, for example, and Lemongrass Drive. So in terms of the exception, this will be maintained by a private HOA. There's, based on 144 residential units, there'd be a park fee of approximately $32,400. And the developer is proposing a number of improvements, which does include a couple covered pavilions, tables, benches, as well as bike racks with a cumulative value of $63,400. The Planning and Zoning Commission does have the authority to approve that with a number of findings, which include amount of parkland contained or the amount of open land that's consumed, the valuation, which does equal and in this case does exceed the minimum park fee requirement. The Park Department has been consulted and does support the improvements as proposed. And so just a map, just to kind of show where those improvements are located, the pavilion, benches, bike rack, and also the trail easement connection that are shown off of Crossvine Drive. So staff recommends approval of the final plat, as well as the requested exception to UDC section 8.3.2 for public park fees. That concludes my presentation, and I will stand by for any questions.
Sorry, didn't mean to jump in on you there.
No
Thank
problem.
You.
You're welcome.
Commissioners, if there's no questions or comments, I'll entertain a motion.
Make a motion. My last motion. I make a motion that we approve FY24-7-PLT as recommended by staff.
Second.
Got a motion by Commissioner Weaver for approval, second by Commissioner Morales. May we have a vote, please?
Yes. Commissioner Morales?
Aye.
Commissioner Walker?
Aye.
Commissioner Jurassic?
Aye.
Commissioner Weaver?
Aye.
Commissioner Carney?
Aye.
Chair Marshall?
Aye.
The vote is unanimous and the motion carries.
With that, we'll conclude the meeting at 7:09. Thank you, everybody.